Good morning, folks. How are you? That's great. Let's stand together as we prepare to worship. And people come in here this morning to be blessed of the Lord. Bible says, make a joyful noise unto all the earth. Amen. So we come in to rejoice, continue to pray, to worship, to honor Jesus Christ. That's why we're here. And we thank you for being here. And we're praying for God's presence to come. The Bible says clearly where two or three are gathered together or in harmony, flowing together in their hearts in harmony, there he is in our midst. Amen? And that is a very critical point to think when we come together on Sunday morning. So let's pray. God, we thank you for this morning. We ask that you would bless each one that's here. Bless those that could not make it this morning, Lord. And we pray wherever your truth goes, wherever people hear your praises, may they be drawn to you. For you've said clearly that if you are lifted up, you will draw all to yourself. So God, we thank you now. We ask your blessing in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Let's enter into worship this morning.
Amen, amen. Good morning.
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes an orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Thank you, Lord. You're worthy of it all. Amen.
This is the message of the book of Titus. And if you just bring up Titus 1, 1 through 5, we're just going to read this right before, even before the worship team sits down. I want you to just ponder these five verses. We're going to be now working through the book of Titus for the next couple of months and asking God to reveal his truth. So let's just read this. Paul, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect and the acknowledgement of the truth which accords with godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began, but has in due time manifested his word through preaching, which was committed to me according to the commandment of God our Savior. To Titus, a true son in our common faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. For this reason, I left you in Crete, that you should set in order the things that are lacking and appoint elders in every city as I commanded you. Amen. You may be seated. Tim Tonello is going to start us off with an exhortation from these verses. Let's welcome Tim back to... You have it? Okay, yeah. Good. Go ahead.
So, as Mr. Jehle said, we're going to focus on Titus. But I'm going to do an intro of Titus. So, follow me on this one because I did my notes like five times and I crunkled up my paper and I was like, oh, you misplaced this word and whatnot. So, bear with me. I know Mr. Jehle. I have all his notes, what he's going to do today. Cheat sheets. Yes, he was my teacher for like 10 years. So the intro is at this time for Titus, the Apostle Paul was released from jail at that time. Now, he discovered there was two churches. It was the church first from Ephesus, and then the church from Crete. Now, he saw the corruption that was going on with not technically the people in the church, but the leaders are following them astray. Following them down a dirty path, so to speak. So the first person he enlisted to go to Ephesus was Timothy. Surprisingly, Mr. Jehle has me in my... So the reason why is to restore the leaders, replacing them, and restore order. So there was a similar situation that's happening on the island of Crete. Now, Mr. Jehle probably will go, where is Crete? I don't even know. So, anybody else know? Except for Mr. Jehle? So the island of Crete, so there was a similar situation. The leaders there that Paul discovered. Now, he founded this church. Obviously, I don't know the timetable, But obviously he was in jail and didn't know what was going on at that time. So he enlisted Timothy for Ephesus. Then he realized the same thing is going on in Crete. So there comes the appointed, Paul appointed Titus to do the exact same thing, replace the leaders that are corrupting the people of the church. So there was this quote from Paul to the church, then to Titus, all about false teaching. But he gives this quote, "The grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all the people." So we see this corruption that is going on, and Paul's message to the church, to Titus, is about grace and God that appeared and offers salvation to all. Not just one person. Everybody. So that's the intro. So getting to Titus, I'm only going to do a synopsis. So I'm only going to do 1 through 4. So starting from 1 through 4, so what I got through studying it, I had to study it pretty quick. Paul's mission was to further the faith and the knowledge of the truth that leads to godliness. So the church that was corrupt at that point, the whole mission of Paul is to get everybody on point, the leaders too, that the truth will lead to godliness in the hope of eternal life that he promised before the beginning of time. This is verse 2. Ponder that, though. Before the beginning of time, how many sat there alone to get to church? No one? Come on, guys. So you probably set your alarm to go to church. You probably set your alarm for a meal after the church. Everything revolves around time. So how in the, just reading it, verse 2, promised eternal life before the beginning of time, before we were even born. It's so hard to comprehend. Even reading it, I'm like, before the beginning of time. Well, time revolves around everything. So that's one thing to ponder. I don't know if we'll ever even understand it till we get to heaven. Maybe not. But we were promised before the beginning of time that we will have eternal life. Now, obviously, you have to believe in God and his word and make sure you're not corrupted by outside leaders coming in. Verse 3, sorry, I got sidetracked. Paul was chosen to bring light and truth of the gospel. Then the charge to Titus, verse 4, sorry. The charge for Titus is the truth of grace and peace from God. Only God gives truth, grace, and peace. So, closing, we see the corruption that is going on in the church of Crete, of teaching a false doctrine. People are backsliding from God. I can attest to that. In my life, I have backsliding years ago. But there is eternal life, right? So I wrote down a different thing. I don't know. Before I close, I always have a song. Always have a song. So it's called Red Letters. Some of you might have heard it from Crowder. Probably been 3 years. Anybody know what red letters means? Right. So, those of you who don't know, red letters obviously is a song, but the song basis is that we were first born sinful. It's weird to think, as a baby, we were born in sin. But through the grace of God, we have eternal life. So the red letter really means you can look at your Bible. It's all black, but there's red letters. When it comes to the Messiah, it starts with the Messiah, and everything that he preached, everything that he said, is a red letter. So, as he dims the lights, and I get off stage, hopefully you guys learned something, because I did. I think that's the point Mr. Jehle has me up here, is for me to learn something.
Son of God hanging on a hill, hell was my destiny. The crowd was shouting, crucify, could have come from these lips of mine. The dirty shame was killing me, it would take a miracle to wash me clean. Then I read the red letters, and the ground began to shake. Prison walls started falling, and I became a free man that day. Lightning hit my veins, my dead heart began to beat. Breath of God filled my lungs, and the Holy Ghost awakened me. Yeah, the Holy Ghost awakened me. When I read the red, we'll be right back.
Thank you, Tim. Good job. And I want you guys to know, though, some of you who don't know Tim, he struggles with a lifelong disease. And he has a difficult time. But I can tell you this, his heart is gold. And God can allow you to overcome whatever it is that you face. And that's exciting to think of. Well, we're going to go to a book of the Bible called Titus. Now, Titus is a small book, and I want to just share a couple of things in brief introduction. We're going to go through those first 4 to 5 verses and deal with this. Now, there's a beautiful way. There are two modes of preaching in the Bible. The Bible says there's two ways to communicate in a preaching style or a teaching style the Word of God. One is expository. Now, that's not a fancy word. It means to do it verse by verse. I mean, that's actually the way it was first written. So when Titus was given, it was given as a letter. It went to Titus, but it was going to the churches that were in that island of Crete, on that island of Crete. And so when you do an expository preaching, which we've done many books of the Bible this way on a Sunday morning, we go verse by verse, and we're trying to say, what did it mean to the people who originally heard it? What did it mean? Then we can make a parallel. Does it have any application today? It does. And so we look at that. Now, we've been doing, for a period of time, thematic studies, which are also biblical, connecting themes across the Bible. We call this horizontal. We call the expository verse by verse vertical, because we are looking at why the book was read, why it was delivered to those people. And the Bible says in the book of Isaiah that all truth is given line upon line and precept upon precept. It forms the cross. It's two ways to look at something. And so we're going to now look, for the next month and a half or so, we're going to look at the book of Titus. So it's going to be very easy for you to say, gee, the next time Pastor Jehle's preaching, what should I read ahead? You can just look at the last verse we did and go a little bit ahead. Now, next week, of course, Ollie's going to continue his series on foundational doctrines. But you see, when we look at this, we want to also know these things. Why was the book of Titus written? Who was it written to? Where did they live? What were their problems? Why is this letter so important? It's so short. 3 short chapters. There are many longer books in the New Testament. And why was it given? And what to the time period was it given? And I'm going to look at this because there were 2 disciples. There were 2 primary disciples. Now, Paul had many of them. The Apostle Paul, as you know, we've done studies on his life and who he was. Probably the individual least likely to be used by God to transform the first century. He was a murderer. He was antichrist. He was looking up Christians that he could drag away and put to death. So Paul the Apostle was, that's why he called himself the least of the apostles. He knew the least likely individual. And yet, secular books have been written about this, that they cannot believe how a guy like the Apostle Paul, who was a murderer, could get converted, dramatically converted to Christ, and then become an instrument to literally transform the first 100 years of church history. At any rate, he had 2 primary disciples. Timothy was a Jew. He was circumcised. He was sent to Ephesus. And he primarily ministered, though not exclusively, to Jews who had come to Christ. Now, Titus was a Greek. He was uncircumcised. And to the Orthodox Jews, that would have been a major problem. But he was sent to Crete. Now, why would you send your Greek disciple to Crete? Actually, the whole world was immersed in Greek thought, the Greek language. Greece had been Greece and Rome were in control, but Rome was kind of the overseer in law and control, but Greek was the influencer. And so even though if you were Roman, you'd have a Roman name. You often had a Roman name, but because you had such influence from Greek philosophy and thought, you had a Greek name. There were usually two names to everything, one Greek and one Roman. And so Rome said that as long as you pinch incense and say the Caesar is sovereign, we'll give you permission to be Greek. And you can do that as long as you realize Rome is sovereign. Now, what ends up happening is you have a sovereign Roman law, permit law. You can't do anything without permission of Caesar and civil government. Civil government is considered to be over everything in everyone's life. And then you have Greek influence. And the influence of Greek thought, Greek wisdom, how you would go about your daily life was usually Greek. So the practical was Greek, but the over ideology was Roman. And the amazing thing is, the longer we have slid away from God in American society, we're becoming Greek and Roman. In fact, the Bible should come alive in its application, unfortunately, partly because it's like Tim was saying, you can backslide, and the churches were backsliding, but one of the things is nations can backslide as well. And so when we look at this, just really quickly, Crete is a small island in the Mediterranean Sea. And so you can see over, you can see Lycia and Pamphylia. This is a, if we kept on going over this here, you go to Italy, and you could see all around the Mediterranean Sea here, and Crete is this island here. The island's about 150 miles long and only 8 to 35 miles wide, so it's very slender, as you can see. Actually, in Crete, the idea of the myth was simply this. They were so dominated with Greek thought and Greek wisdom that they said that in the islands back then, people didn't travel as much. So Roman thought and even Roman law didn't reach islands all that easily. It's much more difficult to put Roman soldiers in boats and take them over to islands. It's much easier to march them across land. And so you had Crete, which was very, very Greek and independently Greek. And during this time period, the first 50 years after Christ comes, the island of Crete was considered the most concentrated Greek thought in all of the Middle East. It was so in-depth that they would say it was the most pagan island, pagan meaning anti-Christian, totally opposite from Christianity, in that area. So whatever areas of Greek thought are a problem, and I'm going to talk about a few, because you won't understand Titus unless you understand what the Apostle Paul was trying to dethrone in the minds of the Christians who were on that island. You have to understand why it was written. It was a targeted letter to dethrone false premises and presuppositions in the minds and hearts of believers because they were in the most concentrated area of Greek thinking. Everything was exaggerated. It was emphasized. It was greater and greater. And, of course, Paul writes his letter around 66 A.D. To Titus from Macedonia or Ephesus because, remember, he sent Timothy to Ephesus and he sent Titus to Crete. And you'll see why, because Titus had such a strong Greek background, he understood what the people were going through. This is the purpose of teaching a book verse by verse, because we understand why it was written. Now, it's interesting, we have to just take a quick tour. I'm not going to go through all of these, but you've heard of the Greek pantheon, right? The Greek gods and the Greek goddesses. Now, it was termed and classified Greek mythology for a reason. It's a myth. It isn't real. Because where did all these gods come from? Did these gods reveal themselves to man? No. man created God in his image. Let's put it this way. If you think about it long enough, you might not like the God that is. You might like to create your own God. I mean, if that was something you could do, you would do that. I was in a debate one time, in a public debate, and the individual who was debating me was saying that, there is no God, and the God that you worship, Dr. Jehle, is a very nasty God because he has rules and whatnot. And then he made a statement to me. He said, Dr. Jehle, I could never accept your God because that's not the kind of God I want. Now, I was about to answer him because I had the last say. I always want the last say in a debate. But they changed the rules immediately as I was about to speak. Didn't give me the last word. But what I was going to say is this. And I was still nice. But what I was going to say is this. It doesn't really matter what kind of God you want. What matters is what kind of God there is. And you see, this was the complete conflict. Because you see, Greek mythology is taking all the problems we have on earth. So let's say there's heartache on earth. There's divorce on earth. There's murder on earth. There's lying and there's cheating and there's stealing on earth. And so what you do is you create an array of gods that divorce, are angry, steal, cheat, and are constantly fighting. These gods never get along because people created gods from the image of our own thought life and our own dreams. We create gods because, after all, we're less guilty if heaven has as many problems as earth. After all, if the gods can't get along, if they constantly cheat on each other, as one of them is both sister and wife of the husband, all the rules. And you have to realize that Greek mythology began about 100 years after Hebrew theology in the Old Testament became completely revealed. And so you had this reaction to Hebrew thought. Now, I'm not going through this, but I'll tell you this. You could take every one of these and you could see that our whole society today has become very Greek. In fact, it started out with just naming things. Zeus is Jupiter and means power, and one of the words in Rome is Thor for that power. And he's the husband of Juno, and it was the beginning of the Olympics. In fact, Crete said that Jupiter was born on the island of Crete. The big guy was born on our island. So we're the Greek of Greeks. We're it. We're to be the most powerful. And of course, we get the word Thursday from our week, from Thor. Hera, and you'll see here, which is kind of like thinking of heaven. She's the wife and sister of Jupiter, but she's a genius. She's beautiful, but she's jealous, angry, vengeful, and constantly destroys marriages. That sounds excitingly example. No. Hephaestus and Vulcan, and of course Vulcan's the root of the word volcano. Get the picture? Constant turmoil in the gods. We could go through. You have Athena, the goddess of wisdom. You have the owl and all those symbols for the library, for the FTD florist. You go on and on and on, and that doesn't make florists bad. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying we've become a society of Greek. The real challenge has become, in the last 80 to 100 years in this nation, we have now absorbed Greek philosophy and Greek thought. And it's not because of Greeks. It's any civilization that rejects the God that is going to end up going down this route. It's not because someone's Greek. It doesn't matter, because we're proving it in America. You don't have to be Greek. You just have to leave the God of the Bible and go down a different path. And that's what happens. See, so if you can get this one idea in your mind that The Greek mythology and the Greek pantheon are gods created after the image of man. But we're created after the image of God. It makes a big difference. Now, I want to just give you this idea. Here's just one thought. Those who had me in universal history. Okay, come on. All right, you should know this. This shouldn't be a shock. But you know that most of Greek thought is a perversion of the truth borrowed from the Hebrews. I'll just give you an example. Hercules. Think of this. And that's because we're studying the book of Titus. And you're saying, yeah, this looks like you're now going into Greek. That's because that's what they believed. So you need to know this. You'll see it. You know, the idea of Hercules probably came from the story of Samson in the Bible. Why? Because they both had immense physical strength, had to escape the clutches of a woman, wrestled with a lion, and were connected with the tribe of Dan in the Old Testament. In fact, it's good evidence that the Greek mythology about the gods were borrowed, tainted, and corrupted 100 years after the Hebrew stories came out in the Old Testament. Because keep this one thought in mind. All false thinking cannot survive without borrowing from the Christian worldview. Because it's not real. You can make up any god you want, but it isn't going to help because it doesn't exist. It might exist in your mind, and therefore, the worldview of Christianity is constantly getting robbed by the other. Remember, Satan never creates, never originates anything. He always counterfeits what God has done. Now, this is what Paul the Apostle is sending Titus to do. How do you go into a culture where the leaders, the pastors, are now mixing Greek thought with Hebrew, which we mean biblical, Old Testament thought, Old Testament thing, mixing it together and mixing it in such a degree that the people are now starting to fall away. They're becoming more and more going back to their culture, and it's everywhere. What do you mean? Well, what do I mean? Well, you see, it had the following. You had the idea that Crete, when he had gone there and everything else, this was the most corrupt area. Can you imagine an island that has no Roman law influence till 67 AD? So this is right after the time the book of Titus is written, at the exact same time. Rome starts to take over Crete and control it around Rome. Why? Because it's absolute anarchy and chaos. Can you imagine a society that simply says there are no absolutes? Everything is right. If you want to do it for your own pleasure, you can do it. Well, what would happen if you had a society that everybody does what they think is best for themselves and they no longer think about what's best for somebody else? You get the island of Crete. What happens when you throw off all law and you say, I can do anything I want? You have more than immorality. You have more than sexual perversion. You have whatever anybody wants to do. It gets combined with violence. And what we would call sadomasochism today is normal on the island of Crete. In fact, it gets even worse, because if you can go into an encyclopedia, you can read these things, you don't have to trust me on it, you have greed, you have theft, because there are now no longer laws. If you feel deprived, you can go take it. You have the right to go take it because you feel deprived. It is what you feel like, not what is. I know any relevance to today is purely true. The point is, there's an aspect of this. What kind of society will you live in? What we don't understand in our own nation is we have so much borrowed capital from previous generations, it's happening slowly. You might think it's happening quickly, but it's happening very slowly. But the capital from previous generations that lived in God is running out. Capital means if I give somebody money to go into business, if I said to Derek, hey, you're going to own a business that's really great, I'm going to give you, I have $500,000. I don't. Okay. I have $500,000. I'm going to give you that for capital investment. Now, he's got to use that wisely. I might have some strings attached to that. I might have that, but man, he doesn't have that. Now he can start investing in it. If he does it right, it's going to make far more than that. He could give me back that $500,000 plus more, but he's going to take that investment and begin to work on it. But if he squanders it, if he doesn't do it, it's going to run out. How many know? You can go through that amount of money quickly, and he comes back and says, you know, man, it just didn't work out for me. Well, I'm probably not writing another $500,000. You know, that wouldn't happen to you, but I'm just saying. The point is, you look at it and you go, how could this be? Well, spiritually, the same laws apply. And we are running out of the previous generation's capital that we've been drawing on. You understand what I'm saying? To the fact now is that we've all become corrupted in this way. So now, let's look at Greek versus Hebrew worldview, and I'm going to go through this by looking at the verses. These are very clear, but I want you to understand. So the Bible starts out here, it says, Paul, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness. Wow, there's a lot in that one verse. You see, in other words, I'm called by God to be who I am. I'm a bondservant. What did he say? I'm a bondservant of the Romans. I'm a bondservant of Jesus Christ. Because Christ, God, created me. Do you realize if God is my creator, I have intrinsic value? If God is my creator, I don't have value because of how much I'm going to give at the temple. I don't have value because of what Rome asserts. I have value because God created me. The reason we say every individual has intrinsic value, including the unborn from conception, the reason we say that is because God is our creator. He made us. And so the whole chapter says, guys, leaders, people in Crete, you're submerged in this Greek thinking. And the Greek thinking is God's made in man's image. Now, they may not have put it that way, but the idea, no, that's opposite. You need to go and get your identity from God himself and get your calling from God himself. He said, according to the faith of God's elect. In other words, this is the truth, but the faith of God's elect is going to make it real. In other words, this is what Paul the Apostle is teaching. God then births each individual in the church in his image. He created him in his image. They now get born again in his image, and it's up to God's elect. He did not say the people should just do whatever the leaders say. See, folks, the problem in America is we're too dependent on flashy preachers, too dependent on televised images. We're too interested in Hollywood type of image. So that if someone is a VIP walks in the room, oh, get the autograph, get all this kind of stuff. And that's demonstrating the fact that no longer are we saying it's the elect of God that are to preserve the truth. We're dependent upon the leaders. And so it makes it easy for the enemy. He can just corrupt leaders and take them out, and the whole church begins to sway. Did you hear what Tim said? It was the leaders that got corrupted. Now you realize this is not going to be the case. You would be the ones that should keep my feet. Imagine the following. If churches across America, when people started to mix grace and works and say, you know, if you're doing okay and you're really trying to make it to God, you're okay. And when the real truth is, none of us are okay. We need the grace of God in order to come and save us, right? We need God himself. We need Jesus Christ. Well, if someone starts preaching something different and the people in the pew begin to say, whoa, time out. I don't think that's right. And they go to the pastor and they go to the individuals. And then they finally say, this pastor, he's bent on being politically correct. He's bent on doing whatever the culture says. He's bent on mixing truth and error and all this. And then the people vote with their feet. There wouldn't be mega churches led astray. There wouldn't be tiny churches. I'm not trying to pick on mega churches. Because the people would say. So now he's saying this. Right from the beginning, it's the grace of God that came directly to God's people individually. The leaders come out from the people of God. The leaders that were corrupt in Crete were corrupt because the people were getting corrupt. So he says, look, let's establish this clearly. The acknowledging of the truth in hope of eternal life, which God, from eternal perspective, is critical, who cannot lie. And as Tim said, before time began, which meant this goes back to God. See, in Greek, in Hebrew thought, we live to please God. It's a seamless truth. All of the world makes sense when you bring in God who created the world. But when you reject that, you live to please yourself. Biblically, his word is what determines what's true. Now, someone said to me, well, you'd say your book is the... What are you talking about? There's plenty of books that claim to be truth. I agree. Try living the way those books tell you. You can't. I mean, discussing it with someone, they said to me, Paul, you're being extreme. You're saying if you took away the revelation of God, people would think murder's okay? Everybody knows murder's wrong. I said, how does everybody know where murder's wrong? Well, because we just grow up knowing it's wrong. How do you know what's wrong? You're the one who decides what God is and what is truth. What if someone decides murder's okay? Well, we live in a society, folks, where murder is okay under certain situations. And I'm not talking about self-defense. We're talking about the situation where, boy, that's because when you throw out the absolutes of God, there are no longer absolutes. There are no longer truth which is fixed, that does not change. See, do you understand what Titus is doing? Right in the introduction, Paul the Apostle is writing to Titus and saying, right in the first few verses, I'm going to lay this down heavy. This is very clear. God is the creator. We live to please him. I'm a bondservant of what? Jesus Christ. His word is the truth. It says, in hope of eternal life, when God that cannot lie promised before the world began. So before the world was even created, God had us in mind. How can anybody know who's going to be born thousands of years later, the one who created everything? Because it all stems from whether God is creator or God is not creator. Either he is what he said he is, or he's not. And if he's not creator, then who is creator? I press upon someone, I might be discussing it, who is creator if God is not creator? Well, we just kind of do what is best. So in other words, you'd like to have public policy set by civil leaders in the area of morality determine what is best in a culture? Yeah, they would generally make the right decision. Really? Well, throughout history, it doesn't pan out that way. Because, listen, if we are selfish and we are the one who creates God, we are the one who creates the kind of morals we want. Because, after all, that's who we are. We just do that if man is central. In fact, you can summarize this whole thing. And Paul the Apostle says to Titus, you want to get off on a good footing, but the only way, now I want to be clear, he's going to give you a quick overview of the book in just a moment, but I want you to understand, so you can see the topics we're going to go into in some depth, you'd have to ask yourself this question. If you had a 3-chapter little letter that you're going to send to several little churches on the island of Crete that are getting immersed in a type of society where anything goes in any area of life, what would you say to them are the essential ingredients the church must embrace? Not to survive, but to transform that culture. Wow. That's the question. You know, we often say when we teach the New Testament to students and we teach it in theology school, we teach it with pastors, all the letters you read in the New Testament, that's what an epistle is, it's a letter, were to answer questions. But we don't have a list of the questions. We just have the answers. Now, I'm glad we have the answers and not just the questions. Okay? I'm glad of the way God did it. I'm not complaining. I'm just saying we can deduce the questions. When we do our homework and we study the background, we can deduce this question. Titus would say, you're sending me to Crete. Okay, I'm Greek too. I understand the whole background. I understand everything I grew up with. I understand where I was, how I was trained, but I'm of a different order now. I'm now saved by God. Now I know God is creator. It's not nature that created, because it's not nature that produced all this stuff. It's God. Okay, that's fine. Well, what would you want me to emphasize? Where do I start? Where do I start with the church in Crete to begin to right this ship? How do I do that? Where do I begin? How are we going to survive? But that's not the way Titus was looking at it, because you'll see clearly in the book. It's not surviving. It's the fact that a small ray of light can dispel darkness. And there can be a transformation of the island of Crete if the churches and the believers begin to set themselves right by reminding themselves. Just like you're being reminded, Ollie preaches on doctrine, which is very, very critical. Here we recognize Paul the Apostle is laying this down clearly. In his essence, he's going through, it's the individual that has value. See, in the Greek, it was the community that had value. You were as valuable as you could contribute to the group. And yet, that's not the case. See, that's the rationale that says we can eliminate certain people in society if we don't think they're going to contribute enough to the group. But if you're in a biblical idea of God, every individual has value. You mean even the mentally challenged? Yes, even them. You go to a Special Olympics and you look in their eyes and you don't tell me they don't have value and significance. Why? They play the game to play the game. And they do it with joy and congratulate the loser and say, great job, I'll get you next time. And you look at that, and what do you see? The image of God. Every individual has value. That's what God teaches. The family is responsible. That's the number one default that Titus will give in the book as well. But the number one, the idea, well, then who's responsible to get this thing overturned? Rome? Jupiter? Who's responsible to do it? The gods are not going to be they're not even responsible to keep harmony in heaven. They're fighting with each other all the time. In fact, when they get mad at each other, they punish the people on the earth. And so then you have to try to appease the gods. But you never know if you truly appease them, because they don't talk to you and you can't talk to them and you can't know them personally. You don't want to know them personally. You don't want Hercules showing up at your door. So what do you do with that? Where do you go? Titus made it clear. You go back to the one who created all things. You go back. And it says here, but he has in times manifested his word through his preaching. See, his word is truth. And now here's another theme in the book of Titus. It's the theme of incarnation. So what did God do when the world was a mess? That meant all darkness in the hearts of people, and they're without hope. The lowest time in history, God sent his son, Jesus. Born in a manger, and God said, God incarnated, the word became flesh, and he dwelt among us. He didn't come from the outside with spaceships, with rockets, with lasers. He could have. He could have come, and then everybody just says, okay, we'll fall in line because I just don't want to get, you know, incinerated. He came and lived among us and inspired us from within. So it is with the Word of God. The Word of God will come through preaching. He's basically telling Titus, what I'm going to tell you in this book, you preach every Sunday. You preach every Wednesday. You preach it. You teach it. Let the Word be incarnated through how you practically can teach this so people can understand it. That's imperative. That's the method. That's not the method of Greek philosophy. And yet, as he says right here, in due time, and he said, which is committed unto me according to the commandment of God our Savior. Notice he came back again. This is not my choice. I am preaching to you because God reached out his hand to me. I never chose to be a preacher. I didn't grow up one day and just say, man, I'd like to stand up there. You kidding me? I ran from my shadow. The only thing that taught me boldness was playing a little ice hockey when I was a kid. Because I either got knocked over or I had to get a little bold. And I was bigger anyway. And they said, how come you keep getting knocked over by someone half your size? Well, okay. Well, maybe I learned a few things, but I tell you this. If you look at it, it's according to the commandment of God. You and I need to recognize we're here because God called us. We're not here because we're smart. We're not here because we have such wisdom. We told Jesus, and we compared the two. We took Greek mythology. We studied that. We studied Hebrew theology, and we just said, you know, I don't know why everybody keeps going this way. We're smart enough. We can take this. That's not how you came to Christ. It's not how I came. God calls. It's by the commandment of God that I walk with him. That's what he was saying. And he said, to Titus, my own son, after the common faith. This is just because he led Titus to Christ. You lead someone to Christ. You disciple them. You give them input. They're, in a sense, a spiritual son or daughter. That's fine. There's an honoring of that, but that means it's from the individual to the group. Do you follow me? Titus, he's writing to Titus with that kind of thing, and our Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, for this cause and reason I left you in Crete so that you might straighten out what was left unfinished, appoint elders in every town. Now, we're going to walk through this and show you how that actually happened, but I want you to note that the family was responsible, you'll see, and that the church actually lights culture. The Greek ideas that experience is truth, whatever I feel is true, is true. Well, if that's the case, how will truth change? Do your feelings like mine go one way one day and another day? Sometimes by the hour, depending on the day, sometimes by every 5 minutes. I like someone, then I think I'm not so sure I do. And then I look at the news and I become a madman. It's like, what do you do? If you go by emotions, you would be all over the place. How many would admit? Don't raise it too high, but somebody will know. Okay, anyway. You go, the family's responsible. Well, in a Greek philosophical sense, the community, which ends up meaning the civil government, is responsible. Somebody else has to be responsible because it's not me. It's the group. Well, who's the group? Well, whatever the group is. Well, what is that group? And you end up there. So let's look at it. What are we going to look at here in this book? If it is true, and this morning, I'll just say how important it is to remind yourself you're created by God. He personally created you. He knows everything about you. And his image is in you, meaning his values, his who he is. It doesn't mean you're automatically godly. You're born with sin, as Tim was describing. But the idea is that conscience, you have a conscience in you that is created by God that will smite you when you do wrong. But the more you ignore it, the less it will smite you. You and I have to recognize it's not because God is in us from birth. We get that way because we're born again, we surrender to Christ. But the idea is God created us. He from time began, before time began, called us. The truth of his word is immutable. It's the foundation. And therefore, we'll talk about this in our next lesson. Next section we're going to deal with, he's going to talk about the fact that Christian character is the critical thing. The number first thing he told them is, you as an individual believer need to live like Christ called you to live. As an example, you're going to be a powerful influence. You need to discern truth from falsehood. Who would not think that that's important today? To discern from truth and falsehood. Strong homes are what influence the church. If the church is going downhill, we need to rebuild the home. We need to restore the home. We need to continually say, it's imperative to do that. Don't think that you're going to restore a culture politically without going back home and restoring it at home. It's not going to happen. It has to go. We need to go home. A church that lights the darkness of a culture. This is what's going to be covered in Titus. Look, if you can strengthen the church, if the families begin praying at home, if they begin working together at home, then the church is going to become a light to others. And then toward the end of the book, you do good works in serving a community. You roll up your sleeves and you serve people, and you serve them without any demands on them. You serve them in love. And you keep your focus on the kingdom and not on Crete. Not on Plymouth. Well, we've been serving for 15 years, and I don't see changes in the following three areas. I had a pastor say that to me and said, your good works philosophy and your idea is ridiculous. I'm just going for the jugular. I don't have time to wait 20, 30 years for a community change. I'm going to change it from the top. I'm going to walk in, and I'm going to tell them how it should be done. I said, let me know how that works out for you. But the idea simply is this. If you do it in love, you can also begin to think, I've done this in love, and I deserve. No, the focus is on the kingdom. So fasten your seatbelts. We're going to have fun. But this is the bottom line. What characteristics would a local church absolutely need if it was placed in a culture that has been increasingly dark with no absolutes that says anything is right and nothing is wrong, whatever you want to do? What characteristics must we have? They're right here. And as I prayed for it, I realized I know a little book in the New Testament that has all these in it. And it's Titus. So that little book, written thousands of years ago, can instruct us today. Amen? So who's your creator? God Almighty and Jesus Christ. Let's stand together. Let's ask God, as you know that there'll be an opportunity for you to come forward and be prayed for by people who are here at the front if you have any need. But let's just go to God. Let's ask God to help us have ears to hear. So next week, you have Ollie dealing with foundational doctrines. The week after that, so it's 2 weeks, by May 8th, when we deal with that, Mother's Day, we're going to have some testimonies and whatnot, but on Mother's Day, I'm going to be dealing with verses 5 through 9. We're going to pick up from verse 5 and go through verse 9. So that's not a lot to read in 2 weeks. I didn't even give Tim 2 weeks. Did I? No, not really. Let's pray. God, we thank you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you. You are our creator. You, Jesus Christ, are our Savior and Lord. Your word is truth. You know all things from beginning to end, from the end to the beginning. And therefore, we can stand solidly on that truth and not fall for all of the things that are surrounding us. So, God, we thank you. Build this into our church that we might be a light at the time in which we live on our station and our watch. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Go in the name of the Lord. If you do have needs, again, come forward. There are people who will be praying for you up here.